of the Q&A with Gospel Q&A with the Kingmaker Apostle Goodwill Magezi. And tonight we are delving further into the subject of supernatural prosperity. And we are looking, the question is, we are examining this blessing of God that makes rich and adds no sorrow, which is the portion of every Christian, believer in Christ. And we are asking, can God, according to what is written in the Bible, can God, the monarch of the universe, the possessor of heaven and earth, the Lord of all wealth, can this God furnish a perpetual lavish lifestyle for his children without subjecting them to the rigors of the hard taskmaster and living by the sweat of their brow? Secondly, does this God that we serve, our Father, does he have the will and the resolve and whatever it takes to support his family on the earth, as we would say in a natural dimension? Is he a responsible parent? The next question, can a believer literally in this day and age inherit nations? Because the Bible has clearly shown us, God has instructed, ask of me and I will give you nations for an inheritance. But in this day and age, the New Testament age, can a believer literally inherit nations? The subject is supernatural prosperity. Then says, can God literally bless the believer? This is very controversial. Can God literally bless the believer, for example, with great and beautiful cities, which he did not build, houses filled with every good thing one can desire in this world, which the believer did not build? Can God give to the believer vineyards or businesses which were established by other people? Can, without any effort on the part of the believer? Now, this is what we are examining today on this Q&A session. Now, I would like to qualify the foundation of supernatural prosperity. What every believer needs to understand is what Christ elaborated when he said in Matthew that seek first the kingdom of God and all these other things shall be added unto you. What does that mean? It simply means that you cannot divorce any promise of God from the identity or person of God. Because it says, seek first the kingdom of God and all these other things shall be added unto you. What does that imply? It implies that you first have to attain the God estate. There is a place called Christ, or the God estate, to which every believer has been translated. And now, knowing that, abiding in the conviction that you have been brought into the God estate, a place called Christ, where all blessings, where every promise of God has already been consummated. Now, this is what marks the difference between a believer in Christ and an unbelieving believer. You know, he has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son, into where the king is. And where is that king? The king is the Christ, which is in you. The Bible tells us that this is the mystery that was hidden from the generation that came before us. Which mystery is Christ in you? This is the container or the consummation of every blessing. Understanding that the king has come to make his home in you. That now every believer bears the fullness of who God is and everything that God has. Now that would solve a lot of unanswered prayer. Why? Because when many Christians, unbelieving Christians, pray, they presume that the things that they would procure from God by prayer are remote from them or are without them. But the Bible clearly tells us that God has already, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, that God has already blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, in whom we live and move and have our being. But these blessings, which are spiritual, cannot be translated into manifestation Until you cultivate or condition your consciousness, your mind, to accommodate them. This is exactly what the Bible means in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, when it says that, I beseech you by the mercies of God to present, first of all, your body or your land as a living sacrifice. Now your body, because the heart or mind is the faculty that controls where your life goes, according to Proverbs chapter 4, verse 13, which says that, guard your heart with all diligence, because out of it are the issues of life. So he says that, I beseech you by the mercies of God to present your life as a living sacrifice, that is, as a vessel for God's purposes. Then he shows you how to do that. He says, be you transformed. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So now this is a vital responsibility of a believer. Whatever is not cultivated in your heart can never be realized in the manifestation. Let me say that again. Whatever you have not conditioned, prepared your heart to receive, can never be manifested in the experience of your life. Let me say it again. Whatever you have not conditioned your heart or mind to accommodate can never be realized, can never be manifested, can never cross the path of your experience in the waking life. Now, that is very powerful. This is divine order. Now, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 11, it says that, he that tills his land shall have plenty of bread. Now, what land is he referring to? It is what Paul the Apostle in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, is calling the renewing of your mind. You can never realize any transformation of your life until you begin to condition, to prepare, to cultivate your heart, your mind, to accommodate God's ideology or philosophy of supernatural prosperity. This same God has told us that he will give you great and beautiful cities which you did not build. That is the will of God for every child of God, for every believer. Now, unfortunately, religious zealots or unbelieving believer have gone about standing in the way that would bring the children of God into the experience of the fullness of his promises. Because having nullified their salvation or the promises of God in their lives because of what they believed, they have chosen to believe the way of the world. What has the world taught? The world teaches the hustle. But you see, God is not a hustler. Let me say that again. God is not a hustler. God is a king, the sovereign ruler and monarch of the universe, the possessor of heaven and earth. And yet, it is this same God in whose image we are made. The purpose of God in Christ was to have us conformed to the image of the Christ, who is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. So, the ultimate, the consummation of the purpose of Christ in every believer is to deliver you into this kingly estate. Now, the word king and hustle do not flow in the same vein. They are mutually exclusive. They cannot exist in the same space. This is what darkness and light cannot coexist. So, hustler, the life of a hustler, which the world imposes on everyone that is under the elements or rudiments of this world, the systems of this world, is not what God has called the believer to. Now, you see, this is why Paul tells us in Romans chapter 12, that be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. What the Solomon in Proverbs says, that he that tills his land shall have plenty. Now, until you learn to cultivate your mind by depositing divine ideas, accommodating them, embracing them, magnifying them, exalting them above everything that the world has taught. You see, there is such a thing, this is what the world calls education. People go to school so that they may receive an impartation of ideas of prosperity according to the world. But there is a prosperity that God has prescribed for the believer, which is contrary, which is far removed from the systems of this world. This is why he tells us not to be conformed to the ways of this world. What, for example, what does the prosperity, the supernatural prosperity that God, if he were on earth, would experience, portray? God has said that I will give you because you are a king. You see now, he says, first seek the kingdom, enter into your kingly estate. It is paramount for every believer to understand that the ultimate is to enter into the God estate. In WhatsApp, you have what you'd call your status. The status of the believer in the dimension of God or in the mind of God is king, ruler, sovereign. Because the Bible also says that as Christ is, so are we in this world. What is the current status of Christ the Lord? He's the Lord. He's the monarch of the universe, the possessor of heaven and earth. All the silver and the gold belongs to our Christ. If at all you are a Bible-believing believer, all the wealth, Christ is the Lord of all wealth. He says that the heavens and the earth and the fullness thereof belong to our Lord, and even them that dwell therein, and he reigns supreme over all things. He's the creator of all things, and all things were made for him, and by him all things are sustained. Now, that same Christ is the one to whom we are joined as the body. The Bible clearly says that he is the head and we are the body. It is impossible, it is illogical, even in physical, in biology, for the head to be rich and the feet to be poor. Because he said, Christ is the head. That is why the church is referred to as the body of Christ. So currently, right now, where is head? Where is the head? What status has Christ attained? Is he the Lord of all wealth? So as the body of Christ, we are the Lord of all wealth. But you see, it will not manifest in your experience until you acknowledge it. The Bible says in Philemon chapter 1 verse 6, it says that the communication of your faith becomes effectual, brings results through the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. That your faith can never bring about the results that is prescribed in the revelation of God's word, the result of supernatural prosperity, until you acknowledge your godly estate, that you are a king. Because as he is, so are you in this world. You have to understand that as a Christian, excuse me, your identity is the golden foundation on which the monument of your life is built. Let me say that again. As a Christian, you have to understand that your identity is the foundation on which your identity is what determines the context and the quality of life that you live. But you see, we have gone about and embraced a foreign philosophy, a philosophy that is contrary to what God would have for us. This is through our experience in secular education. For example, you are a Christian, and yet, by virtue of the education curricula, they taught you that you are a third world citizen. Now, that ideology is what the Bible refers to as the carnal mind, which is hostile to the purpose of God for your life. As long as you have believed and attested and testified that you are a third world citizen because you are born in Uganda, you have made the power of God's supernatural prosperity of none effect in your life. This is exactly what it means, that you cannot put the new wine of supernatural prosperity which Christ has brought into the skin or the wineskin of a third world mindset. You see, the moment you acknowledge anything about yourself, it becomes the driver of your experience. So if you have acknowledged, for example, there are things, there are properties, there are attributes that define a third world nation or a third world citizen, so you are laboring under a delusion. Jesus said, you are in the world, but you are not of the world. So as long as you believe that, see, because you are born physically or biologically in Uganda, you are a third world citizen, you have nullified or made the power of God of none effect in your life. You can never really lend to nations as the Bible prescribes. You see, these promises of God are not things that we really do. The promises or the blessings of God should be effortless and unconscious in the life of a believer who has attained or put on the identity of God. That is exactly what believing entails. Believing means you take upon the identity of the one whom you believe. In this case, that is what he refers to and say, if you believe, whatsoever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of Jesus. That is what believing and doing everything, saying everything, walking in the name of Jesus means, that he has given you the identity of Jesus to leverage for dominion in this world. But when someone gives you an identity, for example, when a person is sworn in as a president of this nation, is it just a label? Or does that office, or the identity that he takes upon himself, His Excellency, the president of such and such a nation, does it wield authority? Does it give him access to resources before which he did not have? Now, this is what it means to believe. You take upon the identity of the one you believe in. Now, unfortunately, many believers or children of God have taken upon themselves and magnified an identity of a fallen nature. They believe in government. They believe in third world systems. They have believed, like God asked Adam, who told you are third world? Who told you are less than the glory of God? Who told you are a poor person because you are born in a poor family? But as long as you have received Christ, the Bible clearly prescribes the way out of poverty. He says, let the poor say, I am rich. This is why we preach the gospel. To make all men see, to bring you into a state, your God estate or God dimension. It is within that estate where supernatural prosperity is effortless and unconscious. You do not force it, or you do not try to arm twist God for anything that you desire. The Bible clearly says in Psalm 16 verse 11 that in your presence, O God, there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. So there is such a place in God, which place is called Christ, where there are pleasures forevermore and fullness of joy. There is a place in God called Christ, where all the promises of God have been fulfilled and prepared for the child of God to enjoy. That is why he says that the kingdom of God is joy, peace, and righteousness. Joy, peace, and righteousness in the God estate. What estate? The Christ estate. Let me qualify this. You can never experience God without God. That sounds funny, but you must take it literally. You can never experience any promise of God outside of God. The only place that you can ever experience the promises of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God is in Christ. That's why he admonishes us on several occasions that whatsoever you do, in word or deed, you must do all in the God estate. What is the God estate? It is our identity, which is Christ. That is why he says that we are the body of Christ. He that is joined to the Lord is one spirit with God. We have been brought into a state of oneness with God. What God has, I have. But now, to manifest it is what Paul refers to as working out your salvation with fear and trembling. What does it mean to work? What Solomon called cultivating your land. It is cultivating your mind with these divine ideas. You see, whatever fills the heart of a man, the mouth will speak. And the mouth was not primarily given to you as an instrument of eating food. Your mouth is the creative instrument of your physical body. Whatever words come out of your mouth will condemn you or justify you. It is by your mouth that you're catapulted into a state of prosperity. And I can tell by what a person utters continuously where that person's life will be in the next month or next year. Because whatever a man is justified by what comes out of his mouth. Now, scripture cannot be broken. That is what God has said. So you see, as long as, how do you determine, how do you channel what comes out of your mouth? It is dependent on what you lay up in your heart. Because it says, whatever fills the heart, the mouth shall speak. Now you see, there are so many Christians who have ignored or who have given themselves to a foreign doctrine, A doctrine that is anti-prosperity. They have not believed on the Christ. What does it mean to believe on the Christ? To believe in everything that he stands for. He died that he may deliver us out of a life of poverty. He who knew no sin becomes sin for me, that I may be catapulted into a life of abundance. It is an obligation for every believing Christian to be rich. Because we are not our own. We are here on a mission, on a purpose. The Bible clearly says that the rich rule over the poor. A poor man cannot preach the gospel. The gospel of the kingdom of God is the gospel of dominion. Dominion and poor are not synonymous. They do not flow in the same vein. Poor men cannot preach. God has not called us to poverty. Jesus Christ, who knew no sin, who knew no poverty, became poor, that everyone that should believe on him is catapulted. He has been brought into a godly estate. Now, there is no poverty in God. Just like the Bible says that he is light, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Darkness and poverty are synonymous. And in him is all the abundance. All the abundance is found in God. You can never experience any promise that God has made outside the identity of God. It is for a Christian to embrace. The vital part in cultivating your heart is for you to take upon yourself the identity of God. That is the most vital part, to identify with God, and then you will win. As he is, so are you in this world. Have you believed that? Because this is the purpose of education, even on a secular level. Someone is taken to the medical school and is imbibed, he's indoctrinated to believe everything that the medical world has laid up. They are told there's such and such a disease which is incurable, which is also contrary to the revelation of the word of God. Now, until you exalt what God said of himself, not even about you, what God said of himself, because as he is, so are you in this world. The purpose of our looking into the mirror or revelation of God's word is laid out in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. It said, we beholding the glory of God as in a mirror. And that mirror is the revelation of God's word. We beholding the glory of God as in a mirror are translated into the same image. Now you see that you become what you look upon. You become what you study. You become what you set your focus on. Now, as long as you have set your focus on knowledge, the knowledge of power, you are always condemning the spirit of prosperity. You are anti-prosperity. Whenever you see rich people going about their business, you condemn them and you magnify the hardness of heart towards them. There is no way that God can deliver you. What you need is to deliver yourself by cultivating, by receiving. This is the root of all envy, that light has come and men have chosen darkness. It is not, for the child of God, it is not hard to prosper. I'm even just using English words, but English limits me. For me to say that it is not hard, prosperity, supernatural prosperity, is the nature of every child of God. It is the nature of God to prosper in everything, because God is life. What is the sign of life? The sign of life is prosperity, is growth, is supernatural increase. It is in our nature as children of God to dominate. Now you see, he says that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Why did Jesus say that? Before he even began any ministry, he had to first accommodate, centralize. He had to first consolidate his status, his position in the earth. He had come as the offspring or reproduction of God. Then when he was about to start his ministry, he had to put on the identity of God. That is where he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And he has anointed me to accomplish this purpose. Now, without the Spirit of the Lord, Jesus could not accomplish what he accomplished. And you know what Jesus said? That because I have given you the same Spirit, the works that I do, will you do? Now, let me provoke religious zealots. He said that, not only did he say that we shall do the works that he did, but this same Jesus said that, and greater works shall you do. Greater works shall you do. Greater works shall you do. We are living in a dispensation of greater works. But do you know what? Do you know why the body of Christ, do you know why religion is void like the fig tree, is void of the fruit of greater works? It's because they have not put on the identity of the Christ, wherein he said that whatsoever you do, in word or deed, you must do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Prosperity, supernatural prosperity, is the fruit of our identity. Supernatural success is the fruit, is the result, is the vital result of our identity. We have been brought into the kingly estate. He has made us kings. That is what the Bible says in Revelations chapter 1, verse 5 and 6. That he has made us kings. It is him. It is not us. He has made us. While other people in the world are trying to attain the kingly status, he has made us, he has qualified us by giving himself as a ransom. God has qualified us for only one position. Number one. That is what he means when he says that you shall be the head and not the tail. This is a place of supernatural prosperity. The question at the beginning was, can God literally bless his children with cities that they did not build? Can God literally give you businesses that you did not construct? Yes, he can. What gives him the right? Because the earth and the fullness thereof belongs to the Lord, our God, our Father, of whom we are heirs. I am the heir of God. My Father, the Lord God Almighty, is the monarch of the universe. Now, if I'm the heir of God, that qualifies me as the rightful owner of all the wealth there is in this world. You have got to be radical enough to believe God for what he says. You have got to be radical enough. This is exactly what it means when it says that the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violence take it by force. The world is saying otherwise, but God is saying that the earth and the fullness thereof belong to God. And all of them that dwell therein, meaning that even the billionaires who built those estates belong to God, are a possession of God, of whom I am the heir. Now, that is a recipe. It is the recipe for supernatural prosperity. It is an identity. It is an outflow of our nature. We do not do supernatural prosperity. Supernatural prosperity is who we are. And yes, we own and possess what God has. I am everything that God is, and I have everything that God has, because I was created in the image and likeness of God. Until we meet again next Sunday on another session of Q&A, we shall delve further into the concept of supernatural prosperity. This is the Kingmaker signing out now.